Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Grace Community Chapel. This thing is being weird today. I don't know why. It just feels intrusive. It's fine. Okay, it's fine now. It's the machines. It's fine. I got it. It's good. Is it falling apart? Did I break it? There. Well, is it working? Okay, yeah. I've just never noticed it being this close before, so it's throwing me off. Anyway. Hey, everyone. How are you guys doing? Good. I'm glad. All right. I'm going to pray, and then we can have a few announcements to start us off. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the day we have here today. We thank you for the promise of summer coming up. And we just thank you for all the blessings that, like that, we don't always think about from you, but are from you. We thank you for the opportunity to be here and to worship you. We pray for your blessing on the service. And we love you. We pray this in your name. Amen. Okay. A few announcements. Speaking of summer, Sunday school is over. It's done. Today was the last one. That's sad. If you didn't come to Sunday school this year, we understand, but we'll start back up in the fall. And it's going to be great, so put that on your calendar, even though I don't have a date yet. Just put fall, Sunday school, circle it. So it's going to be great. Next Sunday, church starts at 10:30. There is no Sunday school, but church starts at 10:30. And then June 6th, church starts at 9:30, new summertime. So if you're not a morning person, I'm sorry.
Watch online.
Or you can watch, like, if you're like, oh, I'm going to be 10 minutes late, just watch it on your phone till you get here. Well, not while you're driving. If your spouse is driving or whoever, you can watch. Anyway, never mind. Just come at 9:30, okay? Just get out of bed, drink some coffee, and come here. Okay? Next week is 10:30. The week after that is 9:30. If you get here at 9:30, just hang out, and we'll be here eventually. I've done that before, so I've been like, where is everybody? Goodness. The rapture going? No, I'm supposed to be there. Anyway. So, yes, June 6th, new service time. I hear there's a VBS meeting on June 7th. So, what time is that at? 6:30 here at the church? Okay, VBS meeting, if you're helping out with that. June 7th. It's also my dad's birthday. Not that you need to know that, but... Well, I don't think he'd come. But, yeah. So that's that. I had announcements and I forgot to write down. Oh, yeah. Just so everybody knows, May 29th, last Saturday of the month, typically the men's breakfast. We're going to cancel that this month. It's Memorial Day weekend. People are not here and I won't be here. So I'm going to forego the men's breakfast for the month of May. We should get back to it in June. Also, small announcement. This is the last Sunday for... required mask wearing here. So, I don't know why you guys are happy. I love this thing. I've had so many comments that have been like, wow, you look so much better with a mask on. And I think that's really nice. Just kidding. So, just wanted to throw that out there. And...
You might add, if somebody wants to wear the mask...
Yeah, if you want to wear a mask, like I said, like, I like it. I'm fine. But yeah, you're not required to not wear a mask. You're required. You can wear a mask if you want to or not. How's that sound? Okay. Yes, exactly. So that is that. Also, June 19th, I said this last week, and just to announce it again, we're going to do a work day at Camp Berea. I've had a couple people say, hey, I want to go. So, there'll be more details coming of that in the next coming weeks, but if you want to help out, get camp ready for the summer, talk to me about it, and I'll get you some more information. Okay. What other announcements did I miss, Jeremy? I feel like there's one. Maybe two, maybe eight. I don't know. Okay. So, we can do some scripture reading. If I remember an announcement during a scripture reading, I'll say it, but... Happy to see all you guys. I don't know if I say that all the time, but I am. So scripture reading is going to be in John chapter, 12. John chapter 12, starting in verse 27.
Yes.
Oh yeah, I forgot one thing. It's not really an announcement, but I just wanted to say, like, so growing up in my church, my grandfather would always do scripture reading. And at the end of, after scripture reading, was the offering. And so my entire life, I've heard the phrase, may the Lord bless the reading of his word, and we'll continue to worship with our tithes and offerings. So that was like ingrained in my mind. So that's what I've done for years and years up here. Well, not years and years, since I've been up here. And now we don't pass the offering plate. We have the box back there where you can put your money in it on your own time, or you can donate online and all that stuff. But it completely throws me off when I'm up here and done. So you'll notice I'll be like, So, working on that, and what I want to do is, I'm probably just going to end with, may the Lord bless the reading of his word. That seems like the easiest thing to do. But then there's like that, you know, 45 seconds, 1 minute when the worship team comes up, and there's like dead space. So, what I was thinking, it would be kind of cool if we just take that minute and 45 seconds, just to say like, you know, quick prayer, just orient your heart for worship, get that started, so when the worship team comes up, we're just ready to praise him, and ready to focus on him. So, that's what I'm going to do, and if I stutter and I'm like, there's another word that's supposed to come out, now you know what's going on in my head, which I know is a scary place to be, but now you have a little bit of background. Okay, scripture reading, John chapter 12, verse 27, and I'm reading out of the ESV Bible this morning. Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name. And then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The crowd that stood there and heard it said that it had thundered. Others said, an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered, this voice has come for your sake, not mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So the crowd answered him, we have heard from the law that the Christ remains forever. How can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is the Son of Man? And so Jesus said to them, the light is among you for a little while longer. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. The one who walks in the darkness does not know where he is going. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of the light. And may the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Well, good morning, everyone. Nice to see you here today, and for those who are watching online, welcome to Grace Community Chapel. It's good to be back. My wife Gail and I were on vacation a couple weeks, but it's good to see the church family. I assume there's smiles behind these. Wave if you're smiling. Yes, good. Okay. We're smiling up here, too. We have some worship music we want to share with you. Won't you join us?
One, two, ready, go. One, two, ready, go.
Are you thirsty? Are you empty? Come and drink these living waters. Living water. Christ is living waters. Lay your life down, all the old gone. Rise up in these living waters. There's a river that flows with mercy and love, bringing joy to the city of our God. There our hope is secure, do not fear anymore. Praise the Lord of living waters. Spirit moving, mercy washing, healing in these living waters. Lead your children to the shoreline. Life is in these living waters. There's a river that flows with mercy and love, bringing joy to the city of our God. There our hope is secure, do not fear anymore. Praise the Lord of living waters. Ooh.
Have a word of prayer. Father of heaven and earth, we praise you this morning and thank you for this time of worship. Help us to dwell in the fruits of the Spirit today. It benefits all of us to be kind, faithful, and to love one another. We ask your blessing on this service and pray for good health for those in attendance and in away. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Sin no more hath dominion. strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Ooh, oh, His grace. Ooh, His word shall not fail you. He
This next song is also a contemporary version of an old hymn that was written back in 1865 by Elvina Hall. It's called Jesus Paid It All. And it's throughout the song, it talks about confessing our inability to save ourselves and our utter dependence on what Christ accomplished on the cross. Just before Christ gave his life on that cross, he cried out, "It is finished." And he bore the weight of the whole world's sin. We thank you for that and ask you to sing along.
Painted wash it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in Him complete, Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat, Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, He washed it white as snow. Life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raise this life up from the dead. Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, He washed it white as snow. Washed it white as snow. He washed it
They'll be here next week.
Okay, it's always that moment risk before Bill gets back to the soundboard to make sure that transition happens. So thank you, Bill. All right. Jesus paid it all. Amen? Amen. Otherwise, there'd be no point in us gathering here today. All right, we're in John chapter 12. You were stuck with me last week, and now you're stuck with me again this week. I promise this is not a pattern. Next week, Paul will be preaching, and then both of your elders are really good at coordinating with each other. We both decided to take a vacation, right? And we both decided to take a vacation the exact same week, June 6th. So neither of us will be here next week, or the next week, June 6th. So that week we have Pastor John Alden coming from Lisbon Falls Baptist Church. He's going to be preaching. And then we'll get back to our regular scheduled program. And then we have Carol Connolly from the Christian Civic League coming on June 20th. So then we'll get back to our regularly scheduled program once again. Okay? So just so you guys know. We're staying in John. John chapter 12. And let's open with a word of prayer. That was to get your attention, just so you know. All right, God, I praise You this morning. I praise Your Son for the fact that Jesus has paid it all. And Father, what a beautiful Son He is. And the fact that the disciples were able to behold the face of God in Christ. And Father, I pray that this morning that we would see Him more clearly through Your text of Scripture. And that we would see how beautiful it is to believe in the promises of Jesus and to believe in His name. We ask these things in your Son's name. Amen. All right, John chapter 12. So if you were with us last week, we had a pretty awesome story. And if you weren't with us, but you were online, thanks for joining online. We had an exciting story about someone coming back from the dead. And we talked about how he wasn't just like sort of dead. He was like dead. In the King James, it says he stinketh, okay? So he was really dead. So he were coming directly out of that. And many of the Jews of the events that saw Lazarus raised, they were pretty excited. I don't know about you, but I would be too, right? I mean, a man who was definitely dead, Jesus goes up to him and says, hey, get out of the tomb, come back to life, and he starts walking around and, you know, eating food with you. It's a pretty big deal. So they're excited. They're like, man, this is it. We talked about how the chief priests and the scribes were basically like, well, we can't deny what he did, so let's just kill him. And in fact, the high priest decided to, he made a prophecy, which he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nations. And he did it, in a sense, unwillingly. Based on that prophecy, like, well, we should kill him. And really, it was all along God saying, yes, he will die for the nations, even for our nation and our people here today. So the priests and the scribes we looked at last week, they commit one another to kill Jesus the first chance they get. And in verse 54 of chapter 11, just going back a little bit, it says, Jesus no longer walked openly among the Jews and went to Ephraim. In fact, when you look at further on, they believed that he wasn't even going to come to the Passover in Jerusalem. They're like, there's no way he's going to come. We kind of put the word out that we're going to put a hit on him as soon as he comes. So he might not even come to Passover. So I want to draw your attention to verse 57. Now the chief priests and the Pharisees had given orders that if anyone knew where he was, he should let them know so that they might arrest him. And this sets the stage for a man who's, we're going to talk about a little bit this morning, a man who sold Jesus for 30 pieces of silver because he knew where Jesus was. All right, John chapter 12. Verse 1. So it's 6 days before the Passover. Jesus therefore came to Bethany where Lazarus was, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. So they gave a dinner for him there. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of the ones reclining at the table. Now, I don't know about you, but if we go to the book of Mark, it also talks about how it was at Simon the leper's house is where this occurred. And I don't know if you know anything about leprosy, but you typically don't hang out with lepers. It's not something you typically do, and they're typically not in the rest of the community with everybody else. So I would argue that the leper was a leper that was a leper that is no longer a leper because of Christ. And then she got him, and then you got Lazarus, the guy who was dead, who is no longer dead, and he's sitting there at the table. This has got to be a pretty cool dinner party, okay? You got one guy who had a disease where his limbs would fall off and skins would fall off and just it was bad. And then you got another guy who was dead. And they're sitting at the table with Jesus. That's the kind of dinner party I'm okay with going to. Okay? I'll take my Friday night out. Right? So it's got to be a pretty exciting party. So anyways, they're all reclining at the table, as was the Jewish custom. Jesus was invited as an honorable guest, as it says in Mark, to this party. The next 24 verses, what we're going to go to, we're going to go to verse 36 this morning. We're going to see five different reactions to Jesus. Five different reactions to Jesus. Five different people groups, five different reactions, and then Jesus' response. So I'm going to give you those five now. First, we're going to see Mary. Then we're going to see Judas Iscariot. Then we're going to see the Jews generally, the chief priests and the Pharisees, the Greeks, and then Jesus' response. And we'll go over those one by one. But the first person we see in verse 3 is Mary. Verse 3 says, Mary therefore took a pound of expensive ointment made from pure nard and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. All right, now, I was going to bring this because Rick brought up something and then Bruce brought up something and everyone's been bringing stuff up to the pulpit, so I felt like I should, but I didn't. Okay, I withheld. So, but a 12-ounce can of Coke. Okay, that's about how much perfume is in this container, about 12 ounces. Now, I could down a 12-ounce can of Coke pretty quickly. But if you notice, if you ever go to an expensive perfume shop, they don't come in 12-ounce packages. I mean, the kind of perfume I would buy would, because I'm cheap. But, you know, but most of the time they come in really small jars because they're really fragrant. 12 ounces is a lot of perfume. It's a lot. And if we know a little bit about the perfume, and we find more when Judas enters the scene, it's an expensive perfume made from pure nard, which is an Indian export. Okay, so this is an exported from a distant country, far, far away, and it's made into this expensive ointment. And in fact, Judas Iscariot later tells us he puts a price tag on it of 300 denarii, which 300 denarii is 300 days of labor, worth of work. Now, when you're living in a society where you're hand to mouth, pretty much, that's a lot. For us, in modern day terms, that'd be about $25,000. So she takes this alabaster flask worth of ointment, breaks it, and pours it all over Jesus, especially his feet. And what's significant is that that isn't even the most significant thing that she does. Let's read what she does again. Mary therefore took a pound of expensive ointment made from pure nard and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. Now, American culture and Jewish culture have one thing in common. We don't like feet. Okay? In Jewish culture, you would never have someone wash your feet that wasn't a slave. Because it was very demeaning. And let's be honest, they wore sandals and they walked around outside all the time. In a very dusty environment. Their feet would get dirty. Okay? And let alone, when you were wiping somebody's feet, you'd probably use some cloth, you know, in a bowl of water. You certainly wouldn't use a fine ointment in your hair. How much more demeaning can it get? But Mary puts all that aside and says, I just want to worship my Savior. She knew who Jesus was. And she gave a completely proper response. Full worship. Mary worshiped Jesus in a way that I think few today could muster. Out of all the people we're going to look at this morning, Mary's probably the most beautiful. She's the worshiper. She comes to Christ and she worships. Going into Verse 4. Now, you can see the scene. Jesus has just had his feet wiped by Mary, and the house is just filled with this beautiful perfume. It's not Axe, okay, so it's not real bad. But Judas Iscariot, one of the disciples, he who was about to betray him, said, why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor? Now, on the face of it, when we read the other Gospels, the disciples kind of all ging in on this. They go, yeah, that's, you know, we help the poor. Helping the poor is important. Jesus' ministry, he described the poor and the oppressed. And he said, help them. So the other disciples were like, yeah, that's a good point. We probably should have done that. What's interesting is that if we had stopped there, and had we have not known who Judas was, as obviously John did, and John wanted to scar him as much as he could, verse 6 says this, he said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. And having charge of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. So Judas is like, you know what? We could have sold this for a lot of money, and I could have gotten my cut. But instead, it was wasted on Jesus. He wasn't caring about the poor. Now, he knew the poor would have gotten the hearts of the disciples and the heart of Jesus. But he didn't care. He just wanted his own cut. Judas demonstrates a fake concern for the poor. Oftentimes we can do that too. It's entirely possible that from what we hear in this text that Judas, the entire time he's been traveling with Jesus, has been seeing dollar signs. Been seeing Jesus of what can I get out of following him? He's thinking he's getting into the next Amazon or the Google or the next Bitcoin, right? Man, this is, I'm getting in the beginning of this. If I ride this out, I could be at the top. What's even more interesting is that in comparison to the flask, Judas betrayed Jesus for less than half the price. 30 silver was about 3 or 4 months of wages. Just enough to invest in the next short-term investment. 30 silver pieces was also the price of a slave. Next person we see this morning is Judas, the freeloader. Just out for himself. What can he get out of Jesus? Verse 7, Jesus' response to Judas, "Leave her alone so that she may keep it for the day of my burial. For the poor you always have with you, but you do not always have me." And Jesus has been talking a lot about this recently. He keeps talking to the disciples and keeps saying, "I'm not going to be around forever." You know, earlier we heard read that he said, "You know, where I'm going, you can't come with me." And the chief priests are like, "What's he going to do? Kill himself?" Right? Jesus is continuing to kind of talk about things are changing. Things are changing. You're not always going to have me here. This is. And Jesus isn't saying we shouldn't care for the poor here, right? This isn't, go dump all the money into the churches and the ivory towers, let's build ourselves these massive cathedrals and not care about the poor. It's not what Jesus is saying. Verse 9. When the large crowd of the Jews learned where Jesus was, they came, not only on account of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. You read this last week. Lazarus is still around. It's kind of cool, right? He was dead. He's now, and people are like, "Wait, he was dead? Yeah, come see him. He's alive and talking and back to normal." It's pretty significant. If I knew just down in Portland there was somebody who was dead for 4 days, that they buried him, put the body in the grave, and then someone came by and said, "Hey, get up out of the grave," and the guy walked out and it wasn't some sort of trick, I'd be like, "I'm going to go see that." Verse 10, so chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well, because on account of him, many Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. I'm going to move a little bit. We're going to keep focusing on the crowd. We'll come back to the chief priests. Verse 12, the next day, the large crowd that had come to the feast had heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went to meet him, crying out, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." And Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, just as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." Verse 16, his disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written about him and had been done to him. The crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb, raised him from the dead, continued to bear witness. The reason why the crowd went to meet him was that they all had heard that he had done this sign. The crowd is following Jesus at this point. He's performed a very notable sign. He performed the healing of the man born blind, and then he, very notably, raised someone from the dead. It's just the kind of escape they've been looking for. He provides signs and miracles. He will be a king to throw off the Romans and make them independent and free again. They believe in him, as it says in verse 11. If we were to go back to verse 11, it says, because on account of him, because of kind of a Lazarus, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. What's interesting is, as Paul will be teaching, in verse 39, the belief was not in the person. And Jesus actually goes on to talk about how you don't actually believe. You believe in the signs, you believe in the wonders. They believed Lazarus was dead and was raised. They didn't really believe anything about what Jesus said about himself. More on that next week. You have to come back. I'm not going to preach on the triumphal entry. There's a lot in that text. And we could go to the other Gospels and we could do kind of a quick mirror on that. Actually, Aaron did a really great breakdown of this on March 28th. So if you want to go back online, you can go back, listen to March 28th. He did a great breakdown of it. So Jesus is coming in, and the crowds are excited. And sometimes I think that we don't realize why they're so excited about him coming in. It's because he just raised someone from the dead. He's just, you know, the man born blind, right? They got these miraculous signs, and they're like, there's something going on here. And they're excited they're going to let him enter into Jerusalem. Now, they all know that the chief priests and the Pharisees want him dead. Like, because Jesus knew that. It kind of spread around the area. Let's go back to the Pharisees' response. Verse 10. So the chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well. Now, we can't deny the sign. Let's just kill the man. Verse 11. Because on account of him, many Jews were going away and believing Jesus. Again, moving forward, verse 19. So the Pharisees said to one another after the triumphal entry, you see that you are gaining nothing. Look, the whole world has gone after him. What are the chief priests, the scribes, the Pharisees, they look to one another and they say, well, you know, he must increase and we must decrease. That's what they said, right? No, what they said is we're just going to increase the body count. Everyone must die who gets in the way of living the life the way that we want it lived. We've got a tradition. We got this all set up. The Romans are letting us do our thing. We kind of got this system going, and Jesus is ruining it. Sure, he performed notable signs. Sure, he might be from God. Sure, we can't deny his signs. But he's ruining it for us. So you got Mary, you got Judas, you got the crowd, and then you got the Pharisees. Verse 20. Now among those who went to worship at the feast were some Greeks. Catch that. They were worshiping the Jewish God, Yahweh, at the Jewish feast. Verse 21, so these came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and asked him, sir, we wish to see Jesus. And Philip went and told Andrew, and Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. What's interesting is, why did they go to Philip? We don't know. The Bible doesn't say. Why did Philip go to Andrew? We don't know. The Bible doesn't say. Did the Greeks actually ever end up talking to Jesus? We don't actually know. John doesn't record it. It's verses like this that remind me of the validity of Scripture, because otherwise, what would be the point in putting that in there? Right? John's like, yeah, you know, the Greeks came over, they talked to Philip, and then Philip went over to talk to Andrew, and they both went to talk to Jesus. Right? Okay, John, why is that in there? Because that's what happened. Verse 23. Jesus answered them, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Truly, truly, I say, unless a grain of wheat falls to the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. If anyone serves me, my Father, the Father, will honor him. So the Greeks come to see Jesus. We don't actually know if they get to see him. And Jesus says something very interesting in his response to at least Philip and Andrew, maybe the Greeks. He says, the hour has come. Now, we've been talking all through John about the hour, right? And they tried to get Jesus, but his hour hadn't come. They tried to get Jesus, but his hour hadn't come. And John's kind of been consistent with that all the way through. And Jesus, this is the first time where Jesus says the hour has come. Now, Jesus doesn't mean 60 minutes from now, psh, it's all over, okay? So we're not talking about literal 60 minutes, not like the TV show, okay? Which is it's only a half hour, right? Or is it a full 60 minutes? I don't remember. Maybe with commercials, it's only 40 minutes. So he says, now is the hour. Jesus sets his mind on the time that's soon around the corner. And he says, this is what it's all been about. This hour is the whole point. Jesus' response to the Greek seeking him is that when the wheat falls to the earth, it dies on its own, but if it dies, it bears much fruit. In an agricultural society, this makes sense, right? You know, so you have a piece of wheat, and it's got seeds in it, and it falls to the ground, it dies, the seeds disperse on the land, and then more wheat is grown. That's how it works. If the wheat doesn't fall to the ground and die, you don't get more. You just have one strand of wheat, which is great, but not enough to make bread. Jesus, seeing the Greeks that have come out, looking to the promise of the nations, knowing that soon the Gentiles will be grafted in. Jesus says, when I fall to the earth, and that wheat falls to the earth and dies, seeds will be planted, and the nations will come. That's exciting, because that's you and me. He then gives the disciples and us a command. Jesus kind of gives a paradox. He says, if you love your life, you're going to lose it. If you hate your life, you'll gain it. Jesus came the first time to hate his life. He came to serve and not be served. In the perspective of the cross, Jesus says, this is the hour that I came for. This is why I'm here. He then says, if anyone serves me, he must follow me, and where I am, there my servant may be also. In reference to the cross, go and do likewise. See your life not for what is it that I have to gain, but what is it that I'm called to give. Verse 27. We're almost there. This is a big section, but I couldn't break it up any other way, so you're going to have to just deal with it. I'm sorry. And if I stopped here, then Paul would have to pick it up, and it would just be hard. Verse 27. Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? This is Jesus talking. Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The crowd that stood there heard it, and that it had thundered. Others said, an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered, the voice has come for your sake, not mine. Jesus starts by his soul is being troubled. He's thinking about what is soon to come and what it means by his hour. And he asks a question. What shall I say? Should I say, Father, save me from this hour? And then his statement, but for this purpose I have come for this hour. And he says, it's a meaningless question. The whole reason why I've done everything up to now is because of this hour. It's the whole reason why I'm here. To ask to be saved from that, which is the whole reason why I came, is kind of silly. Jesus then reflects and says, Father, glorify your name. Because that's the purpose of this. Then we have the voice from heaven. The Father agrees with Jesus' words. Some people hear it as thunder. Others hear it as an angel's voice. It's interesting, Jesus says this was on your account, but some people didn't even hear it. They found a way of excusing it. Ah, something happened. What was that? I don't know, thunder? It might be raining. We can do that. We can find things. We can see things that are clearly God and go, It might just be thunder. Verse 31. Now this is the judgment of the world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. This is big. This is big. I want you to get this. Jesus came. Did he come to judge the world? Do you guys remember? We talked about this in John. I see a couple people shaking their heads. No. He said, I did not come to judge the world. I came, but that they may have life. I came to save the world. But what's interesting is that Jesus recognizes that by his saving the world, there is a coming judgment that he himself will bring. And that the act that is done on the cross brings both salvation and will bring judgment. That's why he says in verse 31, now is the judgment of this world. Because with this very act, Jesus will save and judge. And this time he's just coming to save. Next time he's coming to judge. Jesus makes a distinction that his action of saving the world will glorify the Father as well as the Son and will begin the judgment of the world. He also notes that the ruler of the world will be cast out. Now there's a couple different ways of looking at this, okay? I'm going to give you both. You can make your own interpretation. First way is that Satan will be bound after the cross. That he has no more power on earth. He's done. And he's just got the death throes. It's one opinion. Another opinion is that the authority of Satan and the power of death will be broken. And he will have no more authority on the earth that is not subject to Christ. Okay? Whatever perspective you want to take there, either way, here's the application. Satan's done, either now or soon to be. And whatever power he has left on this earth is granted by the one who is the king. And it's temporary. Don't be on the wrong side. Verse 32. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself. Verse 33, he said this to show by what kind of death he was going to die. What's interesting is Jesus is talking about potentially here the cross. When I am lifted up, and that's what you would do with the cross, you'd lift somebody up. And he's saying this specific phrase because they would get what that kind of means. And so he's basically saying, I'm going to be killed. And he's potentially, you could argue, he's potentially giving the method. And he said that when I am lifted up, I will draw all men. It's interesting, that's not just the Jews. Verse 34. So the crowd answered him, we have heard from the law that the Christ remains forever. How can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is the Son of Man? What's interesting is that the Jews really did believe he was the Messiah at that point, right? Wait, Jesus, you know, you came in, Hosanna, you're riding the donkey, we're doing, you know, you're the king, it's great, you just raised someone from the dead, you've got all this power, you're going to come take over the Romans. We're going to believe you're the Messiah, take care of the Romans for us, and we'll set up our nation for eternity, because that's what the text of Scripture says. Forever kingdom. This is the forever kingdom. We're ready for you to set it up. What do you mean you're going to die? That's not in the plan. What do you mean you're going to be lifted up to die? That doesn't make any sense. If you're not the Messiah, who's this Son of Man? That's what they're asking. Who's the Son of Man? We talked about this once before, and if you were at Wednesday nights a couple weeks, months ago, we were in Daniel. We were talking about Daniel, the Son of Man, who is lifted up from the earth and goes before the throne, right? And how Jesus is using the Son of Man from Daniel to reference himself. Who is this Son of Man, they say in verse 34. Verse 35, Jesus says to them, the light is among you for a little while longer. While you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. The one, walk in light while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. The one who walks in the darkness does not know where he is going. While you have had the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of the light. Jesus commands them that while they are here, while he is here, they should believe in him. There's no easy way to put this, but Jesus says that while he is here, it will be easier for the Jewish people to believe as they have the signs. But once he's gone, as the Apostle Paul puts it, and we're going to read it in a moment, the cross becomes the stumbling block for the Jews. Because they're expecting an eternal kingdom set up, boom, done. And we're good. No more suffering. And that's not why Jesus came. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And we're going to go to verse 18. This is Paul writing. It's his first letter to the Corinthians that we have. Might be a second. Verse 18. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Verse 20, where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has God not made the foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. Verse 22, for Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and folly to the Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. Jesus says, no, you don't get it. I'm here to die. And they go, okay, that doesn't make any sense because you're not the Messiah then. And that's how he sets up the next conversations that he has with his disciples. So, application. Be a worshiper like Mary. Be a worshiper like Mary. No matter the cost, whether it's the cost of worldly goods or the cost of personal dignity, God is worthy of our worship. It's interesting, in our text it says that this will be recorded and it will always be preached with the gospel, her actions. And it's in every gospel story. It's in every single one of the Gospels. Application number two, whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. From the perspective of the cross, if you cling to this life, you will seek to get everything you can from it, but ultimately it will be lost to you. But in the perspective of the cross, if you hate your life, recognizing that the goal of this life is service like Christ, and you will hate your life, and therefore you will gain what you seek, only you'll gain it for eternity. Jesus is drawing people to himself. That was his action on the cross, and that's why he was lifted up. And this next week, if you have the opportunity to serve those who are being drawn, will you? 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5 and 6 says, for what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Christ Jesus as Lord, with ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, let light shine out of darkness, has shone in our hearts and given the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Let's take that light and let's give it to others. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for your scriptures. Thank you that they show us Christ. They show us the interactions of people like Mary and people like Judas and people like the Jews and the Greeks, Father, how they responded, even the scribes and the Pharisees. And Father, I pray that we would learn from how they responded and how Jesus responded back to them. And Father, I pray that this morning that we would glean something from your scriptures that we would take with us into this week and that we would use it to impact our lives and make us more and better servants of your Son, Jesus. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I noticed that Jeremy used the word beautiful several times in his prayer and during the sermon, and that's also part of the name of this next song, Beautiful Savior. Please join us.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Beautiful Savior and a wonderful Counselor. We thank you for this time together, and that we were able to learn from your word. Help us to think of the many people that can't be here today due to sickness or other commitments. Pray for them, lift them up. Help us throughout the week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3.
Beautiful Savior, wonderful Counselor, clothed in majesty, Lord of history.